you walk in, there's kind of a gate that turns a little bit every time you go in, right? And it's keeping track of how many people are going in. And then when you go out this, and it's going to say, okay, someone left. So you can only leave the stadium if you went in. So it turns out it keeps a counter that can add, it can subtract, but it's always positive. Okay? So this works under what's called the turnstile model, where when I'm processing something in the stream, I might say that I have an element and I'm adding it, or I might say one of the elements I had is leaving. Okay? And I don't have to keep track of them in between. The turnstile doesn't keep track of everyone in the stadium, it just adds one and deletes one. And so let's say there are different sorts of people. There's the VIP people and so forth. They go through different turnstiles. They have a different counter maybe. But I have lots of type and I want to use some hash function to keep track of them. I can add and I can subtract. So if I have an element coming in and it's actually a subtraction, then when I go here and I update my counter, I can actually do a subtraction here instead of an addition. And the whole analysis goes through. Instead of, now m is still the sum of the frequency counts. It's not the number of elements in the stream. So you can have many more elements in the stream than you have your total frequency counts at the end. So that's why you write it in terms of this bound usually. If they're only adding, it's the same as m. But if you have many fewer elements at the end, let's say a lot of people left, you have a much better estimate. So actually this bound at the end, you can actually write this as is actually f of j plus epsilon times f1. So this f1 might be a lot smaller at the end, and when it gets smaller, your error gets better. So when you're doing additions and subtractions, you can handle it using this algorithm. And so this is what's known as a sketch. You have some simple each element corresponds with a certain counter, and then you do some linear operations on these, or some sort of operations on these counters. If you kept two of these at two different turnstiles at different parts of the stadium, you can then kind of take the two turnstiles and add them together. And as long as you use the same random numbers for your hash functions, you can just add the counts. You can do additions and subtractions, and everything works. So if someone walked in one turnstile and out the other, when you added them up, everything will make sense. So this is more powerful than the Misha Gries algorithm, the space-saving algorithm we talked about Wednesday. They can't handle these sorts of updates. And so this is a very powerful concept, and there are a lot of different sorts of summaries based on this sort of thing where you keep this array of counters. And then you kind of do some operation on this, and it somehow has encoded all the data. You have to use, you know, all these hash functions to recover it, the data somehow, but you somehow encoded it in here in some special way. Okay, so this was the count min sketch. The count sketch is going to be a little different. So let me just give a quick overview of the difference here. And I'll just write on top of this. So we're not going to have the min. So instead what we're going to have is these extra hash functions. We're going to have also a g1, a g2, up to a gt. And these g of r is going to go from all of our input, and it's going to go to -1, +1. So it's just choosing a sign, okay? And then when we do here, we're going to, instead of +1, we're going to do plus r of ai. So what we're going to do is we're going to choose a column the same way as before. And then given that column with the second hash function, we're going to choose to increment or decrement. and all of the elements, so everything that's the same tweet, will, if it hits this counter, will either always increase or always decrease. So then when we retrieve it, we want to look at, so then this part needs to change a little bit. And we no longer have this guarantee. We no longer always have an overcount. We're going to need to do something other than the min here. We're going to say that f of j hat is going to be the median over r in t of the counter it corresponds to times g r j. So I'm going to look at the counter and multiply it by the sign. So if it was always subtracting, then I take the negative of whatever the counter is. So all these counters, so the key, and I'm taking the median now instead of the minimum because I can have errors on either side. The key difference is that if I look at the part of the counter which was not from element j, the expected value of that is going to be 0. Because all the other elements that hash to it, they're each going to hash to with probably 1 over k, which is good. But then, in addition, half the time they're going to be minus 1, half the time they're going to be plus 1. So in expectation, those average out. I can't use the Markov inequality anymore. I'll need to use something called the Chebyshev inequality, which is uses the variance instead of the expected value. And then you end up getting a bound that's based on F2 instead of F1. Yeah, I miswrote this bound here before. This is actually F2, which is epsilon times. So I'm going to get it's the sum over these counts squared. And this comes from you're doing analysis based on the variance of these random variables now. You need to square them. This F2 is likely much smaller than F1. So this is a better bound. It turns out then the size here needs to be 4 over epsilon squared. And this needs to be 2 times log 1 over delta. So I need to increase the size of my table a little bit. But the F2 is going to give me a stronger bound. And the other good thing is that the expected value of my answer is going to be the right expected value. The count min sketch always is biased. The count sketch is unbiased. So in expectation, I'm going to have the right answer, which is good. So the other thing I'll mention, for those of you who know like random projections or the Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma, where you take a high-dimensional point set and project it down to a low-dimensional point set, and you can preserve distances this way. The count sketch is, under certain sort of analysis, is essentially doing the same thing. It's the same sort of analysis there. The choosing a plus one random variable here, when you do a Johnson-Lindenstrauss projection, this is like going to be is a Gaussian random variable, but you can use a plus one or minus one instead, and you can get the same results for Johnson-Lindenstrauss projection lemma. So this analysis seems to be similar. So in data mining class next semester, if you take that, you'll learn about that. So it uses the analysis for count sketch is a little simpler. But the analysis is, but in principle, it's doing something very similar. Okay. So that gives you an idea of how the count sketch works. And in practice, it depends on what your data looks like, whether it has a smaller F2 value than you probably want to do. You probably want to do the count sketch. So this is going to be large only if the data is very skewed. right? So if you wanted to recover m, if you want this, if you wanted the square root sum of j of fj squared, if you want this to be equal to m, the only way that's possible is if all of the count is on a single element. If the count is spread out, then by squaring them all and taking the square root, it's just really going to shrink this a lot. So this can be a lot smaller. So if your data is not very skewed, then this will give you a much better estimate. Okay, so I'll stop there, and if you have questions about the analysis, I can try and answer them after this.
This is almost making me think we need to leave the video camera running while you answer questions after class.
All right,
this is powerful stuff.
Okay, yeah. So it's pretty cool. These are really cool techniques, and they have a lot of applications. These are just the simplest versions of them. But something common about this is the algorithm is really simple to implement. If you want to do this, implementing this is really, really easy. The analysis and understanding why it works is trickier, right? But to do it, it takes a little space, and you get, and these are in production and in certain places where they're trying to keep counts like this and detect these really heavy items.
Sorry, for count sketch, I can understand. After that, if hat, you said that we couldn't use that one anymore, and we need to change to.
So you can't use the analysis for the Markov inequality. The Markov inequality gives a bound on the probability you pass some value, only using the expected value. The Chebyshev bound. Let me just write this off. Is that you have a random variable x. I don't know if you need such that you have the expected value and the variance. So you know the expected value and the variance. I think this is less than. So then you say the probability that x is greater than some beta is going to be less than, the probability that the x minus the expected value, the difference between x and the expected value is greater than beta, is going to be less than the variance of x over beta squared. So if the expected value is zero, then that's just the error from what you expect on x, right? So this is how far you are from the expected value. You don't want this to be very large. The probability that this is large depends on the variance, and the larger you make this difference, the smaller the probability gets. And it goes down with beta squared now instead of variance. And so basically what you can show...
Is beta also greater than zero?
Yeah, beta is greater than zero. And so you can show that the variance of your error for any j is going to be, what is it going to be equal to? The F2 error squared over k. Okay, so then what you're going to do, or something like...
What's F2?
So F2 is the sum of the squared things, the sum of the squared frequency counts, square root.
Okay.
Right, so then if you plug this in here, if you want this to be less, if you set beta equals to, and now K was 4 over epsilon squared, so K equals 4 over epsilon squared, so then this is equal to F2 squared epsilon squared over 4. So I want to set beta equals to epsilon F2. Then I put beta squared in here, and I say that this probability is less than, F2 squared epsilon squared over 4, divided by 4. I guess I think this was a 2. 4 over epsilon squared. The epsilon no, the epsilon's on top. Right, so now if I write this, I want an epsilon F2, right, squared. The F2 squared and the epsilon squared cancel, and I'm going to get left is going to be, this was 4. Okay, so I'm going to get left is going to be less or equal to 1/4. That's basically how it works. So then if you look at the difference, so now I need to do something like this again, but I'm using the median. So I need to do it on two different sides. So instead of using a 1/2 here, I need to do 2 times 1/2 to the t, and that's why I needed the 1/4. And that's why I had 4 over epsilon squared instead of 2 over epsilon squared. And I need 2 log 1 over delta again because I'm gonna have an extra factor here because I'm using the median instead of the minimum. But this argument is roughly the same, except I say the larger it's on, if I look at the median, that means over at least half of them need to be larger than some factor or smaller than some factor. And so I have two sides to that. But the argument here is similar. Any other questions?